Welcome to our 2024 lived experience event. Please enjoy this video of Riverside CFO Patrick Chilcott speaking at our 2022 lived experience celebration.
I've talked to friends of mine that are going through a lot right now, several of them in the last year, and I very privately shared that I'm talking to someone and what it's doing for me. That my recovery has been powerful in that regard, because I can share something that, first of all, some are very surprised by, mm-hmm. and very shocked by, but all of a sudden, if I'm doing it, it's okay. And that is power. Sharing that has power, and it's getting others help. So I think destigmatizing where we are and making it okay for everyone mm-hmm. to be able to seek out that help is why I'm doing this.
Please welcome Patrick Chilcott, Riverside's Chief Financial Officer.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our event. I was incredibly honored when Dr. Angela asked me to do this. And just to give some context, because a lot of you haven't been here over the last 2 years or since that video, and maybe don't understand sort of the beginning of my journey. And I think you have to know where someone started in order to understand where they are today, in the power of the healing, in the power of moving forward. In mid-2017, my mother was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer. And we went through that journey with her. And she was hospitalized for the last time in late January of 2018. And about a week before, 2 weeks before, I got a text message from my older brother, who had addiction in his home, alcoholism in his home, and a series of other things, said, "I've been arrested on a pretty serious felony, and I'm in jail." And I had to immediately drive to New Hampshire and sit in a courtroom and tell a judge, without asking my family or anyone else, in order for him to be released, that he could come live with me. So those are pretty two significant stresses. I then proceeded to spend 3 weeks in an intensive care room watching my mother die. And she passed in mid-February of 2018. Things stabilized for a little bit, going through my brother's challenges and issues and trying to get him some help and get him into some form of services and recovery. And his court case went in August of 2020, where I had to go and testify for him and against my nephew. And those things, I mean, that's just trauma in and of itself. On September 9th of 2020, I got a phone call and found out that my dad, who sat in his chair, drank a beer, watching the news, fell asleep, and the good Lord took him to go see my mother right out of nowhere. And I'm like, wow, you know, so I got in the car. I knew I was going to have to be there for my siblings and be there for my family. And I drove back to Buffalo and I buried my father. 15 days later, I got a phone call that said that my older brother, who had just moved out of my house, was in a very serious car accident and was killed. And I literally was changing the names on paperwork for the church for another funeral mass. And I had to then go and care for my niece and be there for my siblings and pick out an urn and go through two wakes. And it was like, oh my God. At the same time, you all know Scott Bach, who then got sick. And then about a year later, he passed. And the whole time I said, I'm fine. I'm okay. I'm okay. I'm strong. I can do this. I need to be there for my family. I need to be there for my kids. I need to be there for my siblings. I'm okay. And then one day I woke up and I knew I wasn't okay. I was surrounded by darkness and depression and stress, and nothing was okay. And I didn't know what to do. I was a 50-something year old guy who was literally needing help, and I had no idea how to ask for it. I had no idea. I hadn't learned how to do it. I didn't know what I had to do. My wife sat me down and said, "You have to go talk to somebody." And I found a therapist that I could trust and that I could work with. And I learned that it was okay. And I learned that I needed to let some light in, and that I had to relearn joy. I had to relearn stability. I had to relearn not living in trauma and in chaos. And it was hard. I mean, I had to look at some stuff and it was hard. But the end of the journey, and it took about 2 years, was unbelievable. And it's interesting. I'm a big believer. I'm very spiritual. I'm a very faith-based individual. And I believe you get signs at all the right times. And I literally in the last 2 weeks, I knew this was coming. And I've been thinking about what am I going to tell everybody? And how do I convey that there is a path to healing? There is a path to peace. Learning that it was okay for me to be vulnerable, which is not an area I'm good at all, right? I'm a chief financial officer. I'm a bit of a control freak. Everything has an order. Everything has a place. And in learning the vulnerability and learning that it's okay to share and be vulnerable helped me help other folks. But about 10 days ago, I flew in to Kona, Hawaii, and I got to our hotel with my wife. We're celebrating our 25th wedding anniversary. It was an awesome time. And I show up at the hotel, and the hotel is having a fundraiser for the North Hawaii Hospice Association. And it was a candle lighting that you did for people who had passed. And we made a donation, and I got a candle, and my wife got a candle. And for me, it was this joyous push toward peace and comfort. And I realized in that moment, I did it, right? Like, I made it through the journey and through the pain to get to a place where I could do this, and it was joyful. But at the same time, I watched my wife in pain because in the last 6 weeks or so, she's lost three people, one of them to suicide, very close to her. And I realized my pain, my vulnerability, my journey was about to help her. And that's what this is. That's what the journey of peace in healing is about. It's about taking our experiences, our lived experiences, and putting it forward to somebody else and helping them find peace. My wife was not somebody who was going to go to therapy, was not somebody who was going to talk to somebody. We're two Gen X kids that grew up in a very blue-collar way, who were latchkey kids, and that just wasn't part of who we were. And she's now been in therapy for about 2 or 3 months on her own journey. And I'm so grateful for that. I have another very good friend who just lost his wife, and I'm helping him get services. So I guess my message is we go from pain to promise, and we go from an ability to really look and examine ourselves and be willing to say, I've got to relearn who I am and who I want to be. And that brings comfort, it helps others get to joy, and it helps those around us move forward. So I would say to you, if this 50 plus year old guy who never thought he could get there can do it, if you're struggling, if you're in a place where you're not sure, where you're surrounded by chaos or clouded by darkness, just reach out. You can reach out to me, reach out to a professional, but don't be afraid to be vulnerable and don't be afraid to get help. And I really appreciate you letting me reshare this story and kind of move forward and show you that you can get to peace and healing. So thank you.
Please welcome Dr. Angela Crutchfield, Vice President for Diversity, Inclusion, and Organizational Excellence, Riverside Community Care.
Thank you so much, Patrick. I tell you, you are just amazing to me. Your incredible vulnerability today, just, I can't even get my words out. It's so amazing that you are so open and sharing in the way that you have. It is a powerful testament to the importance of sharing who we are and our experiences. And you, as a senior leader who is willing to share not just the successes that you've had in your career and in the financial world, but also the challenges that come with the healing journey. Your openness, it creates a space for others to feel safe in their own stories. And that, my friend, is a gift. And as we gather here today, I want to officially welcome all of you to our virtual event, our Diversity and Inclusion Lived Experience event. It's one of our three events that we have every year at Riverside, and we are so excited to have you join us. We're reminded that healing is not just a one-time event. It's a journey, a thoughtful journey that takes time, it takes patience, and grace with ourselves. Healing is not just about moving away from pain. It's about moving towards something much deeper. I call it wholeness. In addition to my role within Riverside Community Care, I am a lifestyle coach and I focus in on wholeness. And I believe deeply in the connection between healing and wholeness. Healing sets that foundation, but it's the journey towards wholeness where we reclaim our authentic selves, where we align all parts of our lives, physical, emotional, spiritual, social, career, and economic. It's something more complete and more peaceful. I call it peace wholeness, P-E-S-S-C-E. It's wholeness. So I encourage you to move towards your journey. Today's event is an event of encouragement. We are here to uplift and remind each other that no matter where you are in your journey and your own lived experience, keep moving forward. The healing journey, it's always personal, but it's not one we need to take alone. As Patrick just reminded us, we are here to support one another, to share our stories, and to find strength in our collective resilience. As we continue today's program, let's remember that each of us has the power to transform our pains into peace, our struggles into strength, and our healing into wholeness. That's a lot of what we're about at Riverside Community Care. Those of you who are joining us, a part of our staff, we appreciate you. Those who are not a part of our staff, thank you for joining us so you can just get a glimpse into the goodness of what we do in support of our staff and, of course, in support of the people that we serve. Thank you all for being here, and let's continue to embrace this journey together.
Please welcome Louie Mackey, Technology Navigator and Chair of Riverside's Power of Lived Experience Employee Resource Group.
Thank you and good morning, everyone. During our planning for this event, one of the first ideas I had was around the complexity of the healing journey. I wanted to examine some of the nuance that comes day to day as a person with mental health challenges. During my first 2 years in the human services field, fresh out of college, I barely examined those challenges and feared ever discussing them. Despite this fear, I was considered by my colleagues to be a competent and dependable staff member. Rough around the edges, for sure, but I dedicated time to getting to know the folks I worked with and dove headfirst into any and every obstacle. I was taking on extra responsibilities to teach and mentor fellow counselors new to my program or staying late to do something another staff member didn't know how to do. What I kept secret during that time was the fact that I couldn't keep up with paperwork. On occasion, working during my weekend for a few hours just so I could get paperwork done in before the 72 hours was up, so no one would know I'm struggling with it. I had no energy to do anything during my week after work. I didn't use a single vacation day for myself until after my first year, where I was politely encouraged to take a week off in the near future. This lack of a work-life balance did lead to a tipping point where after Riverside lost a contract in that area, I shortly after quit the new company I was working for without a backup plan. I had set goals for myself to get back to work, but I struggled. I would think about doing things for hours, not having moved a spot from my couch and angry at myself for not moving. I had intense bouts of malaise and apathy. I didn't sign myself up for mass health or unemployment because I thought I didn't deserve it. That lasted about 6 months. When struggles like this happened, I used to work on completely removing these feelings altogether, trying to overthink and rationalize my emotions instead of just feeling them. It used to mean each other feeling either meant absolutely nothing or some intense life-altering event was right around the corner. I've made peace with my big feelings and now allow for the gray and that once binary black and white way of thinking. If these struggles come up, I take the time off that I need to get myself back into the right headspace to show up for work and, more importantly, myself. What I've recently come to embrace is that instead of fearing the change, I'm able to soothe myself now and tell the part of me that used to react this way to survive that we're okay. My fears of complete and total world-ending events aren't possible anymore, as I've allowed myself to build a wide variety of friends, colleagues, and loved ones over the years. If something goes wrong, I no longer need to spend hours of free time thinking about potential solutions to future problems I thought might happen. I now know that I can arise to any challenge, and if I can't do it alone, I have the support around me to make it happen. My own formal ADHD diagnosis in the last few years allowed myself grace in ways I never thought possible. I still can get caught up in the moment to hyper-focus on a task and then the next day not be able to finish any task. I found strength in recognizing that these struggles with attention and memory were not personal character faults and that there were techniques to help me stay on task. I always have some kind of notes on me now and often interrupt conversations to write something down so I don't forget it. I stopped getting upset with myself for needing to ask for these things, finding a self-love and caring for an inner child that once hated themselves. When I first started my career in Riverside Community Care, I was ashamed to ever let anyone know the complex life I lead day to day. Now, I recognize the value in speaking up and collaborating with Riverside at this time to create a pilot training to empower staff to talk about our experiences. Now, with the knowledge that this stigma can be overcome, that it is okay to share your story, and that you aren't alone in this struggle. It is okay to take time away, to heal, and come back. We owe ourselves that much. As I reflect on my own healing journey today, I've really come to understand that embracing authenticity is key to truly thriving. Today's musical guest, Professor Jerome Kiles, embodies this message of authenticity. His work focuses on living authentically, and through his music and teaching, he inspires others to embrace their true selves, no matter how difficult the climb may be. I'm honored to introduce him now. Thank you.
Please welcome Professor Jerome Kiles, Berklee College of Music, 20-year voice department professor.
Good morning, everyone. When we think about healing, it's often a journey back to our most authentic selves. Authenticity is about embracing who we truly are, free from the mask that we wear or the expectations placed on us. It's only when we live authentically that real healing begins, because we no longer carry the weight of trying to be something that we're not. As we continue this journey of unlearning and adapting, we remember that healing is not always easy. It's a climb. There are moments when the path feels steep, but it's in those moments that we grow the most. This next song, The Climb, speaks to that struggle and the strength we find in pushing forward. I hope it reminds you that every step you take, no matter how difficult, brings you closer to wholeness. I can almost see that dream I'm dreaming. There's a voice inside my head saying, you'll never reach it. Every step I'm taking, every move I make feels lost with no direction. My faith is shaking, but I gotta keep trying. Gotta keep my head held high. Yeah, there's always gonna be another mountain. Always gonna wanna make it move. Always gonna be an uphill battle. Sometimes you're gonna have to lose. Ain't know how fast I get there. Ain't about what's waiting on the other side. Oh, it's the climb. The struggles I'm facing, the chances I'm taking, sometimes it might knock me down, but no, I'm not breaking. I may not know it, but these are the moments that I'm gonna remember most. Just gotta keep going, but I've gotta be strong and just keep pressing on. Oh, there's always gonna be another mountain. Always gonna wanna make it move. Always gonna be an uphill battle. Sometimes you're gonna have to lose. Ain't about how fast I get there. Ain't about what's waiting on the other side. It's the climb. Whoa. Just keep climbing higher and higher still. Gonna be another mountain. Always gonna wanna make it move. Always gonna be an uphill battle. Sometimes you're gonna have to lose. Ain't about how fast I get there. Ain't about what's waiting on the other side. It's the climb. Faith, yeah, just keep your faith and keep pushing on and keep pressing on, climbing higher still. It's the climb.
Please welcome Vicar DeGravio, Riverside's president and CEO.
Wow, that was incredible. Thank you so much, Professor Kyles, and thank you to Louis, Dr. Angela, and Patrick for sharing your thoughts, and Louis and Patrick especially sharing your experiences. It's a privilege to be here with you, all of you, our other program participants, and everyone watching as we gather for this important conversation about what healing truly means. As we consider the journey of healing, it's impossible not to think of Scott Bach, Riverside's visionary founder and former CEO who passed away in 2021. Scott's passion for supporting the most vulnerable and his dedication to compassionate care built the foundation upon which Riverside Community Care stands today. For many of us, Scott's passing marked a profound moment of loss, a time when our community had to come together, navigate the grief, and find a path forward. Honoring Scott's memory has been a crucial part of our own healing journey as an organization. Through initiatives like the Scott M. Bach Leadership Society, we carry forward his legacy, keeping his spirit alive in our work. This has allowed us to not only reflect on the values he championed, but also to reaffirm our commitment to our mission. But healing is more than honoring the past. It's about charting a course forward, a course that brings with it the strengths and values Scott instilled in us, while also adapting to meet new challenges and opportunities. As an organization, Riverside has had to reframe certain ways of thinking to adapt and to thrive in a constantly changing world. We continue to embrace a strategy for innovation, inclusion, and growth that will allow us to build on the virtues of Riverside while ensuring we remain responsive to the needs of those we serve. I am committed to ensuring that our journey forward is grounded in the principles of diversity, inclusion, and cultural competence. With the lived experiences of those we serve and our staff are not just considered, but are central to our approach. We recognize that healing looks different for each individual, and our services must reflect the unique abilities and experiences of every person. At Riverside, we strive to create an environment where all voices are heard, where lived experience informs our care and services, and where everyone can find the support they need to thrive. This commitment is not just part of our mission, it's a reflection of the values Scott believed in deeply, and it guides us as we adapt to the evolving needs of our community. Today, it's my great honor to introduce our keynote speaker, Michelle Dickinson. Michelle is a passionate advocate for mental health, sharing her personal journey and insights to help others find their path to healing. Her work embodies the themes we've gathered here to explore today: the power of unlearning old patterns, adapting to new challenges, and finding strength in our own vulnerability. Please join me in welcoming Michelle Dickinson.
Good morning, everyone. It is truly an honor to be with you today. How many of you recognize this house? I might be showing my age here. Well, this house is the Leave It to Beaver house from the show, the sitcom broadcast in the 1960s. Well, it was the home where everything was absolutely perfect, if you remember correctly. It was the perfect American family. Well, guys, that was my life. My life at age 45 was predictable, was consistent. I had landed a good job. I had stability in my life, certainty every single day. I was married and we lived in a quaint little neighborhood that I really loved. We lived in this cute house that many people referred to as the doll house, because from the outside looking in, every little detail just seemed to be totally perfect. We had an adorable dog named Pepsi, and I had finally figured out my skincare routine. Well, guys, at the age of 46, my entire life was about to change with the realization that we were divorcing. And I remember opening my eyes in the morning and just thinking to myself, I'm living a nightmare, like this heavy blanket just weighing me down, preventing me from moving. All I wanted to do was pull those covers up over my head and just forget about my life. And I remember looking out the window, up at the trees, wondering day after day, was it even worth getting out of bed? But more about that in a moment. Now, it wasn't like I had never lived with uncertainty before in my life. It had just been over 25 years since I had to deal with it. You see, I grew up with a mother who suffered from bipolar disorder. She was a lot like a walking Katy Perry song. She was hot, then she was cold, Then she was a yes, then she was a no. And for those of you who've never lived with somebody suffering from bipolar disorder, it's a disorder associated with episodes of mood swing ranging from depressive lows to manic highs. The treatment for my mom was lifelong, and it involved a combination of medications, some shock therapy, and psychotherapy. But for me as a child, it was a lot like riding a roller coaster, and I just had to learn how to hang on for that ride. I never knew the mom that I was coming home to after school. When she was manic, she was often extremely happy, taking me on shopping sprees with her, getting ice cream sundaes. It was great. But when she was not and she was manic, it was ugly. And she could be very mean, abusive, both physically and mentally, making the age-old statement ring true that oftentimes the hurt others. And when she was low, her deep, depressing lows, she was crippled by tears, unable to function. And I remember there was a time when I came bouncing down the stairs with a brand new outfit to wear for school. And I was so excited about going to school. And my dad just looked at me with this look and he said, "I need you to stay home with her today. I can't miss another day of work and she's just not in a good place." And there we were once again in that fragile moment where she's not sick enough to go to the hospital, but not strong enough to be left alone. Now, my mom, she ended up passing away several years ago. And unfortunately, she never really got the help she needed. She struggled with depression until the day she died. Now, regardless of my challenging upbringing, I went on and I spent 19 amazing years in a corporate career. And in my last corporate role, I was nominated to give a TED Talk, but it was a TED Talk about my mom. It was an amazing experience nonetheless. The reaction that I received from giving my TED Talk inspired me to write my memoir. My memoir entitled Breaking Into My Life is my story. And it was my vehicle to heal and to let go of the anger that I had for my mother's abusive ways. My memoir shares my life living with my mom and has touched the lives of so many people who share a similar abusive experience. Now, thankfully, I have had the good fortune to heal, to realize that not everyone diagnosed with bipolar disorder is like my mother. And I'm so grateful to have come to realize that my journey with my mom was absolutely perfect. It taught me deep compassion and empathy and set me on my trajectory to help others with the resilience work I do today. And I can now say that I'm grateful for all of it. And that was something I was not always able to say. Healing is so important. Now back to my story, fast forward, and it's a cold Monday morning in March several years ago. I just went to court to finalize my divorce of 16 years. 2 days later, that same week on a Wednesday, I was told that my corporate position was eliminated. So in 1 week, I lost my marriage and my job. I hit rock bottom. And for the first time in my life, I was the one dealing with depression. Fortunately, I didn't fear treatment. I knew I needed to get help. So I reached out to a therapist and I listened to him. And I'm so glad that I did. Sometimes in our lives, guys, we really just need to listen to those around us. So he challenged me to find healthy vices to help myself. So I did just that. My cousin challenged me to train for the New Jersey State Triathlon for the very first time ever. So what that meant were weeks of physical training, eating well, and just getting stronger and faster. And let me tell you, the massive sense of accomplishment that I experienced crossing the finish line was euphoric. It made me realize I was strong. And if I could do that, I could overcome my other life challenges. Physical fitness has always shown up for me as a metaphor for life. That experience gave me some positive momentum and elevated my confidence. And so that spilled into the other areas of my life. That experience gave me the courage to not go back into a corporate job, but to instead create my own path forward. And I've always had this burning fire in my belly to help people. And so that's what I set out to do. I started my own company and I never looked back. That brings me to exactly where I am today. I have literally been able to transform myself in so many amazing ways because I've done the hard work, because I healed to grow and to reach for my dreams, regardless of my past. I've healed physically, emotionally, and I've grown professionally. Now, as an entrepreneur, I wear many different hats. I'm a resilience visionary, a burnout interventionist, a coach, and a trainer. I've dedicated years to trying to understand this burnout epidemic that we're experiencing. I've coached hundreds of people, logging over 5,000 hours of one-on-one resilience coaching. And I've learned a lot, and I've gathered a lot of data. More importantly, I've learned what works when it comes to helping people avoid burnout. And I want to share my top 5 tips with you today. So, what is resilience as a lifestyle? In our practice, we believe that we are repeatedly what we think and we are repeatedly what we do. So, if we want to feel good, we have to look at our mindset and our practices. So, I have 5 tips that seem to make a big difference for my clients. The first one I want to share with you, I want to get clear with you and be a little bit in your face today. Is guys, nobody's coming to save you. Burnout is real and caring for ourselves is so important. Yet oftentimes we don't relate to self-care as being vital. And we know that excess stress and neglecting ourselves every day is going to set us up for burnout and even worse. We also have to get the impact of neglecting ourselves, guys, because our loved ones are the ones that will suffer the most. So let's start thinking about self-care as the oxygen mask that we put on ourselves first before we help anyone else. The following 5 tips are not a list of ideas generated on ChatGPT, I promise you. These are based on real data, the things that have actually been proven to help my clients recalibrate themselves, feel better, and avoid hitting burnout. So guys, if you're struggling with low energy or high stress, pay attention. There might be something here for you. So my 5 tips, the first one that seems to be the one that we don't really think about, but is so important is don't fall into your day. What do I mean by that? How many of us are hitting snooze, catapulting out of bed, grabbing coffee, getting into traffic, getting to work, and we're already stressed out? My invitation, take 10 minutes for yourself to intentionally start your day. Maybe it's a cup of coffee sitting in prayer. Maybe it's a cup of coffee just sitting with yourself for a few moments. You get to declare how the cadence of the day will unfold. So give yourself the moment in the morning before you rush into your day just to fill your cup a little bit. The second one, focusing on the good. Guys, our minds are not wired to make us happy. Our minds are wired to protect us. So organically, they want to worry and they want to think about all of your problems. And when we do that, we step over all of the love and all the abundance that is right in front of us. So when we redirect our thoughts to our gratitude, to things that actually feel good and the things that are going well, we give ourselves a chance to have a good day. Next, meditation. The average mind has 60,000 thoughts per day. So that's a lot of noise in our head. We have to be thinking about how can we silence some of that noise. So it's about finding a few moments for yourself every day just to be with yourself. When we practice meditation, we're retraining ourselves how to be present with ourselves. And if we can be present with ourselves, we can give the gift of our presence to our loved ones. So remember that. And I am a stickler about sleep. Sleep is literally the unsung hero of resilience. Sleep is absolutely essential in helping us prepare to deal with stress. And the two things that we know are showing up for us day after day is stress and adversity. So the only thing we can do is focus on making sure we're prepared to just ebb and flow with what's coming. So getting your sleep, getting to bed at a decent time, making sure you're not shaving hours off of sleep when you have too much to do, because that's just a recipe for disaster. And then finally, my fifth tip is movement, because movement is our body's stress relief valve. So movement can help us process stress, help us feel better. And guys, I don't want you to overthink this one. Just go for a walk. Grab your sneakers and go for a walk. Okay, so my invitation to you is stop waiting for external circumstances to change in order to take care of ourselves. Because here's the thing, there's never going to be an optimal time to take care of yourself. You need to claim that time for yourself and give yourself a chance to have a good day, making your self-care a non-negotiable. Because when we feel good, we're able to seek out and appreciate the small victories and joyful moments in our day, because guys, we're actually able to see them and appreciate them. You can't do that when you're overwhelmed and you're stressed. So I challenge you to adopt just one stress management tool. It could be meditation, it could be walking, and just really commit to that. And remember the impact of not caring for yourself. Your loved ones do not deserve a watered-down version of you. By prioritizing your self-care, you ensure that you show up for those that you love. Thank you guys so much for having me. It was truly a privilege to get to be part of such an amazing program. I am so grateful. Please, you're welcome to follow me for more of my resilience tips. Any questions?
I see somebody has raised their hand. I'm gonna view their question and then send it over to you, Michelle.
Awesome.
Whoever has raised their hand.
Hi.
Please feel free. Oh, awesome.
Hi, my
please
name
ask
is
your question.
My name is Elise. I work as a certified peer specialist with Riverside Community Care. I just want to say thank you so much, Michelle. I could basically, the burnout is such a avoidable thing, and what you talked about is so real, and I just want to thank you, because I need some comments in the chat. You know, move a muscle, change a thought, don't wait until the pain gets great enough. You know, my priority is self-care. I cannot pour from an empty vessel, and it's so important to remember that. You know, I have work, and I have outside work where I participate in recovery also, and there's balance with all of these things. I am going to feel better, and I know it. The thing is making the commitment to do it, and my focus has been on self-care, and I just want to thank you for mentioning those 5 points today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Amazing. Keep going. You're doing great.
Thank you so much for your incredible keynote speech, Michelle. And now, please welcome Amy Sika, Riverside's Vice President of Recovery and Peer Services.
Thank you, Patrick, Louis, and Michelle, for your vulnerability and trust in sharing your journeys. Your stories exemplify what healing can truly mean: unlearning, adapting, and thriving together. Here at Riverside Community Care, we take immense pride in our growing lived experience workforce. Now, although our roles may vary by title, we're all united by our personal experiences. This can be with mental health, with substance use, or supporting a loved one as they navigate their own journey towards wellness. each and every story adds depth and understanding to our mission. And that's because the power of peer support lies in the capacity for mutual healing. It embodies hope, not just for those seeking support, but for those of us providing it. By integrating lived experience roles into our programs, we're able to establish non-clinical care that's built on that foundation of mutuality. It creates an environment where individuals can support one another, sharing our insights and our strengths, and validating the experience of every single person involved. And that's because in peer support, healing is a two-way street. Those of us who have navigated our challenges can offer invaluable empathy and support. By sharing our stories, we help others feel less alone, and this mutual exchange nurtures resilience and growth. Our firsthand knowledge of the complexities of the healing journey make our support especially impactful. One really cool thing that we've seen here at Riverside is from our lived experience team members sharing their journeys, we've been able to cultivate environments where other people have the safety to be able to do so as well. Patrick and Louis' stories earlier this morning are a perfect example of this. And it's because we emphasize the importance of creating a space where people feel comfortable expressing their challenges. Now, admittedly, I had a challenging time transitioning my speech to the concept of friendship because sometimes peer support can be misinterpreted as paid friends. Thankfully, I was reminded that through peer support, individuals have a space where they can openly explore what they want these relationships to look like in their life and practice the skills to enhance the relationships. And it's one of those things, while professional peer support may be a newer concept for some people, the practice of peer support has arguably existed forever in one capacity or another. I invite everyone to think about a moment where you faced a challenging situation. Was there somebody who stood by you? Perhaps it was a friend who listened without interruption, or a family member who simply said, "I get it, I've been there too." These gestures, although they can seem small, can actually carry immense weight. They remind us that we're not alone in our challenges and that there are people who genuinely care about our well-being. This could be friends, family, or chosen family. Ideally, we support individuals as they build a community that aligns with their own personalized needs, furthering their growth and healing. It's not just about having people around us, right? But it's the quality of those relationships. Genuine connections can foster a sense of belonging and purpose, which ultimately can be instrumental as we continue our journey towards wellness. In closing, let's not forget about the incredible role that friends, family, and chosen family play in our healing journeys. As we reflect on these connections, I'm excited to introduce a song that perfectly captures the essence of friendship and support. Please join me in listening to "That's What Friends Are For." This timeless tune reminds us through both good and bad times, true friends will always be there for us. Enjoy.
And I never thought I'd feel this way. And as far as I'm concerned, I'm glad I got the chance to say that I do believe I love you. And if I should ever go away, well then close your eyes and know the way we feel today. And then if you can remember, smiling and keep shining, knowing you can always count on me for sure. That's what friends are for good times and in bad times. I'll be on your side forevermore. That's what friends are for. Well, you came and opened me, and now there's so much more I see. And so, by the way, I thank you. Oh, and then for the times that we're apart, well then close your eyes and know These words are coming from my heart. And then if you can remember, keep smiling and keep shining, knowing you can always count on me. For sure, that's what friends are for good times and for bad times. I'll be on your side forevermore. That's what friends are for. Keep smiling and keep shining, knowing you can always count on me. For sure, that's what friends are for. For good times and for bad times, I'll be on your side forevermore. That's what friends are for. And keep smiling and keep shining, knowing you can always count on me. For sure, that's what friends are for the good times and for bad times. I'll be on your side forevermore. That's what friends are for.
Please welcome Anna Standish, Diversity and Inclusion Specialist and Trainer for Riverside Community Care.
Hello, everybody. Organizing the Lift Experience, event is one of the highlights of my work here at Riverside because it's such an important conversation, and I'm thrilled that we can all be part of it today. None of this would be possible without the amazing support of our tech team, which is always so incredible to make sure everything runs smoothly with this event. Our marketing team, the Lift Experience Events Committee, and of course, our Diversity and Inclusion Committee members. Thank you all for your support and your dedication. I also like to spotlight our amazing employee resource group, DLC, Paul, BIPA, and TA. Our ERGs are at the heart of our DEI initiatives, and we're always looking for new voices. If you are a Riverside employee and you're passionate about making a difference, joining an ERG is a great way to get involved and to support change within Riverside. So if you're interested, please reach out via email. We have shared the emails on the chat for each one of the ERGs. We have also shared the pop-up shop link on the chat, just in case you like to spruce around and check out some Riverside swag. Now let's talk giveaway. So we have five amazing giveaways today. We will be choosing five winners randomly. So as soon as you hear your name, please claim your prize by saying here on the chat. We will have to move on if there's no response for the next name. So please be sure as soon as you hear your name, to sit here on the chat so you're able to claim your prize. With that said, let's see who's ready to win. Take it away. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, everyone, for attending today's event. Our first giveaway winner is Sydney Baker. Next, we have Stan Arnold. Our third winner is Angela Letty. For the fourth winner, it's Frederick Mann. Up next, our final winner is Jackie Hurst. I see that Sydney and Frederick have responded in the chat. Thank you guys for letting us know that you were here. We're gonna randomly select some other winners now, make sure that somebody in attendance can take home the prize. Our next winner is Bonnie Scanlon. Next up is Lauren Boltello. Awesome. We have Jackie, Lauren, Sydney, and Frederick. And our final winner is Ada Moran. Awesome. Ada is here. Congratulations to all our giveaway recipients. And now, please welcome again, Dr. Angela Crutchfield.
Wow, wow, wow. Another amazing event. I'm so thankful for you all being a part of our event today. What a powerful time that we've had sharing together, hearing stories of vulnerability, strength, and healing. And today has been a reminder of the importance of your healing journey, a journey that takes us through unlearning, adapting, ultimately thriving. Our theme for today, healing, the powerful journey of unlearning, adapting, thriving, it has brought to life things that, you know, some of you may have even not even thought about. It's come to life today through the voices and the stories that we've shared. Healing is not just an individual experience. It's something that we all engage in collectively. And it's through our shared journeys that we grow. We grow stronger as a community. Our healing journey is an ongoing process of unlearning what no longer serves us, adapting to new realities, and thriving by embracing our full, authentic selves. I want to thank everyone who's been a part of this. Our special guests, Michelle, we so appreciate you sharing with us today as our keynote. And Professor Kyles, thank you. You have participated with us before, and having you back again has been nothing but amazing. Thank you so much. All of our speakers, Vic, we appreciate you and your continued support of this diversity and inclusion effort that we have underway within the organization. Patrick, your vulnerability, I can't say the word today, vulnerability continues to just stand out for me. I really appreciate the tech team. Everyone, thank you so much.